say that John's involved in a lot of very really neat technologies that you may have seen upstairs, a lot of neat new companies. And John has built from the ground up the industry on part of the industry in which we are now riding. And I think his involvement here today is a very good sign that we have a very great talent to add to our efforts to legitimize and then help us build Avatar Cyberspace as a business to find strikes and goals. So without further ado, I'd like to pass it on to John Scully. Welcome.
Well, thank you very much, and I've just been thrilled to be here over the last 2 days. And Bruce, congratulations to you on this first event. I think we'll look back on this years from now as one of those seminal moments when a lot of things came together. I know for me, it really helped me get on the learning curve of many things that you all have been doing, and to try to connect some of the things which I'm involved with, and it's just been an extraordinary couple of days. It's very difficult when you're doing the closing wrap-up talk to add much new information, and we're probably all in overload at this point anyway, so what I'd like to do is to try to put into context some of the things that have been discussed. There have been some wonderful ideas that have been presented. But I think this is one of those very important, discontinuous changing times. It seems a little bit odd that the web is only a few years old, and yet I would suggest to you that the phenomenon of the web is going to go through a discontinuous change, and it may well be starting with many of the people who are in this audience. To get a context of what I mean, we need to step back a few years, even a few decades, to look at the history of the personal computer. Because the personal computer was really beginning back in the 1960s with Doug Engelbart, who had some of the really breakthrough ideas, and actually some of his ideas are just getting implemented now, because he did have the first idea of computers talking over networks to other computers, in addition to creating the mouse pointing device. And Alan Kay with the Dynabook in the late 1960s, and development of Smalltalk, and then through Xerox PARC we saw development of what eventually became the Macintosh and Windows 95. And then down another path, I can actually remember seeing that issue of Popular Science when it showed the Altair on it, and trying to figure out who in the world would want a little box with lights and switches. Bill Gates was smarter than I. He knew exactly what to do with that little box of lights and switches, and quit Harvard and went off and started creating an implementation of BASIC. But the point is that when the computer industry began to turn into the personal computer industry, it didn't really look like what it looks like today. It took many decades in order to take shape. And yet the clues were there when we look backwards. You know, we can see the sort of moments that started to define what actually happened and what we take for granted as almost a commodity in life today, like the telephone or the automobile or television. And so we need to have that sort of ability to go back to the future, to step out a couple of decades and then look back to 1996 to see what's happening right now, to get the context of just how important this change is. The personal computer has defined a metaphor of the desktop. It has a user interface that's built around icons, and it focuses on the document as not only how that metaphor is expressed, but also where the real utility takes place. And for many of us, the vision was the empowerment of the individual. And I would suggest to you that what we are looking at now is not just the integration of the desktop into the web, and clearly that's happening, and Microsoft is going to do a very good job of integrating Internet Explorer together with the Windows operating system, together with the Office suite of applications, but that there is a chance to do something that is probably even more important. And that is to shift the metaphor from the empowerment of the individual to looking at the group intelligence that is created when people are networked together. I had the privilege a few weeks before Dr. Jonas Salk died to have breakfast with him and John Perry Barlow and Martin Greenberger, and we were talking about where is all of this stuff going. And Dr. Salk, who at that time was 80 years old, almost about to have his 81st birthday, said that the two most important things in his life was to focus on a cure for AIDS, which he was working on at the Salk Institute in San Diego, and to focus on what he considered to be the most significant change in humankind since Darwin discovered natural selection, and that is what he called the metabiological revolution. And the metabiological revolution was built on the idea that when you can start to connect the minds, connect the neurons and the synapses between individuals, that you start to get a collective wisdom. Some of us remember it as the beehive principle or swarm theory, but it's really more than that, because what we're talking about is the ability to start to look at a metaphor that leverages not individual empowerment, but leverages the socializing experience of minds being able to join together in ways that are very hard for us to predict, because it involves not only the predictable things that we can do when we start out to create communities or to create avatars, but it involves randomness, and it may even involve ideas of chaos theory. And as we heard in the wonderful discussion earlier today with biota.org, that there is a new digital primordial soup that is stirring up. And just as we went from the Precambrian days of methane-breeding creatures to the carbon-based life that we know with what's on the planet today, that there is going to be out there in this digital soup entirely new life forms, entirely new models of life structure that may well be as ambitious as the biota.org presenters discussed today. But what's important to us in the near term is that we are starting to see an entirely new kind of experience that is happening right now. This is not something we have to wait 100 years to see the implications, but it's happening right now. And that's why I think the user interface that starts to focus not on the simulation of models, the simplest one being, let's say, a spreadsheet, but one which focuses on the creation of synthetic worlds, and where you can be represented by an avatar that's not a digital puppet, but an avatar that embodies the spirit of real human beings, as well as the representations, which will get better and better, obviously, as the technology improves, that this is the extraordinary discontinuous change. There is another discontinuous change that is entirely different that's going on, and one which I feel a little more comfortable talking about than the one I just did, and that is the reinvention of marketing. I spent most of my professional life in marketing, and it was either selling soft drinks or software or potato chips or computer chips and all those kinds of things. And it was always about selling something. You were measured on return on investment, return on assets employed, market share. So the end goal was to sell something. And that's not what marketing is about anymore. Marketing today, the end goal is about owning the customer relationship. The metrics have changed. The metrics are now churn. The metrics are loyalty. It's about owning the customer relationship. And that's why we see today companies giving away things in order to get that customer relationship. And we see the metrics of the investment community that's spending all of this money and all of these new IPOs and expansion of new businesses is not focused as much on profit, but they're looking at a very simple model which says if you can have a monopoly in an emerging market that's sustainable, that's a pretty good business model, regardless of whether you're making any money right now. And that's why you can see businesses like McCall Communications that had 2.2 million subscribers and never made a dollar of profit selling themselves to AT&T for $17.4 billion when you include the $5 billion of assumption of debt. Or TCI that has never made a profit and yet has 13 million subscribers is able to convince the financial community that you shouldn't measure a company, if it's a growth company, on its profits. In fact, growth companies shouldn't be making any profits. You should measure it on the sustainability of the customers or subscribers that it has, and you should look at a multiple of cash flow. And so the metrics are changing, the ground rules are changing, and marketing is changing. And so the shift now is to one-to-one marketing, it's to database marketing, and we're starting to see another shift, because it is only a few years ago that we heard the Vice President of the United States tell us that we were going to be moving into the era of the information superhighway. Now, the problem with that wonderful proclamation is that that is looking at the future, you know, through a rearview mirror, because it's essentially looking back at the old industrial age economy, which said that things are based upon the resources that come out of the ground, like coal and oil and wheat, and yet we're not talking about physical highways with tarmac and rebar and concrete, but what we're talking about is a world that is far more interesting than the convergence of computers and communications and content. We're really talking about the information supermarket, not the information superhighway. And the information supermarket is going to be defined in its building blocks by not the three C's of computers, content, and communications, but it's going to be defined by the building blocks of community, of commerce, and customization. And we've all talked a great deal about community and the power of community, and the fact that in a socializing experience that you've got self-organizing groups that come together because they have special interests in common, and from a commerce standpoint, that has incredible value. Those of us who are looking for business models. Why? Because when you get people talking together about things that they're interested in, they're going to be more likely to buy the kinds of things that match their programs. And so you start to look at technologies like collaborative filtering or tying back to databases where people have expressed interests, intentions, or you're tracking their behavior by what they did or where they visit, you can start to see that you can map experience of people and intentions of people in the interest groups that they associate in, and so they become very, very valuable potential customers for people who are selling services or selling products. And to put that into perspective, again, as a marketing person, if we look at the cost of losing a customer, we start to see the value of owning the customer relationship. For example, I saw a study that was done a few years ago that went across a number of different industry segments. And what it showed was that the cost of replacing a lost customer was about 5 times more to get that new customer up to the same level of revenue as the customer that you lost. So if you held on to the original customer, it would have been a lot more efficient in terms of your investment than if you had lost that customer. And why did America Online make profits, you know, 3 years ago when Prodigy was losing money? You only had to look at one metric. The churn rate for Prodigy was 50 to 60%, and the churn rate of customers for AOL at that time was around 20%. You know, just that one metric, you know, made a huge difference in the profitability. To replace the profit that's lost with a customer, it doesn't cost 5 times more as it does with revenue. It costs about 16 times more. And now you start to see why, you know, businesses where you can own a customer relationship are so important, and why you're willing to give something away in order to keep that customer happy so that you can sell them upgrades or find other ways to keep them a loyal customer to your particular service or business. Now, if we look out at the internet as it exists today, we really don't get a very good model for most of us of how to find a business model out of all that. We heard earlier that the place where people are making money on the internet today is not on the web, even though the web kind of started all this phenomenon and took us from the world of internet and file transfer protocols to the world of HTML editors and HTTP, hypertext transport protocols, that what's really happening is that we have seen the intranets, and probably in the future it will be the extranets, which mean the intranets that are within a company being connected with the intranets that are in other companies. And if we have secure transaction, those extranets become more and more valuable. And that's where the Netscapes of the world and the Microsofts of the world and the Oracles of the world are putting most of their attention. And they wouldn't be doing it if they didn't think that's where the money is going to be made. So the web starts to see a lot of its concepts being co-opted and moved into the business-to-business marketplace. And what's left with the rest of the web? What's left, unfortunately, is primarily something that looks more like CB radio than it looks like cellular telephones, meaning that it's more of a curiosity that stimulates our interest rather than something that has real utility. And the advertising that we see on the web is more resembling junk mail than it is real advertising as we would know it in other media. So I would suggest to you that the web, as wonderful a phenomenon as it is, is in great need of reinvention. And it may be that the concepts that we're talking about here with community and socializing and new user interfaces that are not documents and icons but are focused on avatars and their interaction with each other and the ability to go into synthetic community spaces may be the beginning of something that has far more value in terms of getting lots of people to want to partake in it than what we've seen so far. Now, I see probably two different models that, there may be more, but at least there are two that I've had some interest in following more recently. One of those models, when you move away from the intranet and the extranet, is the impact of multiple media asset companies. And by this, I mean companies like a Disney or a Time Warner who have intellectual property that can be leveraged across multiple media. It's not multimedia, it's multiple media. It means you bring out Lion King as a movie, and you then bring out the home video, and you bring out the CD-ROM, and you bring out the books, and you bring out the merchandise, and you could bring out the online web services. And so with these large media asset companies, what we will see, I believe, is that a lot of the talent that had been focused just a few years ago when trying to do CD-ROM development is now starting to switch over because that has not turned out to be as good an economic model as people had thought. They're starting to switch over to the web, and what's going to pay for that development, I think, are going to be these large media companies that are going to be building things that more and more start to resemble the television world where the entertainment company came from. Now, it doesn't mean it's going to be a passive broadcast media that just happens to be delivered over the internet. More likely, it's going to be interactive. It'll be more personalized. It'll have a lot of the characteristics that we would hope that the evolution of the web would have. But these web broadcasting models, or webcasting, or web channels, or whatever the nomenclature that is eventually adopted, more and more we're going to start to see that they will take on the quality of television and the quality of the best CD-ROMs and the quality of the best special effects films. And this means that the kind of things that are going on in the vermal world and the merging of vermal and multimedia environments is going to become more and more important, because these are going to be the enabling tools that will be used by these webcasters. And the amount of money that they can afford to spend and the amount of money they can afford to lose is going to be significant. And so the telephone companies have finally figured out that that's none of their business. They bring nothing to it. And so they've gone back and focused on what they should have focused on in the first place, which is to become ISPs. And so we're seeing that the internet service providers, who were small little startup companies, are now either consolidating or disappearing as the large telcos realize that that's their business to be in. And they're going to be the ones who will make the investment in ADSL modems. They'll make the investment if it's the cable MSOs and cable modems. If it's satellite delivery, they're the ones who will make the investment in direct PC and the transponders. And they're the ones who will be getting the connect charge, you know, for what has been up until now free. It's not going to be a free lunch. We're going to start to see a connect charge, I think, for quality of service. And people will pay for that, which means that the online service companies like America Online and Prodigy and CompuServe have a real problem ahead of them. Because they've been charging a connect charge for a pay-per-view of somebody else's content, and all of a sudden the connect charge will only be for a quality of delivery of bandwidth, and the content more and more is going to be free, and the big media companies can live with that model because they can leverage with multiple media where they can take the profits in many different places. If it's a character-based show, they can sell the merchandise, toys, games, collectibles, and soft goods. You know, and more, we're going to start to see advertising, not this junk mail advertising that is out there today, but look at television. The quality of the commercial is not a lower production value than the quality of the show. So why is it that we would expect people to have this great multimedia avatar in a synthetic community and experience and then turn around and show them a little banner, you know, ad with a Java applet or Shockwave animation running? So I think we're going to start to see as much quality in the production of television, or excuse me, the production of interactive commercials over this next generation of the internet, as we will see in the quality of the shows and programming themselves. And as we look out to a second model, I would suggest that we look again at history and take a look at what Ted Turner did with Turner Broadcasting Systems back in the early 1980s. Because what Ted did was he looked around and said, gee, the news business has a very strange gathering model, which is that they gather news every day and spend a lot of money doing it, CBS, ABC, NBC, to put together a half hour of news presentation each evening. And what he did, either consciously or unconsciously, he took advantage of the camcorder, a very inexpensive way of capturing video, and started to equip people all around the world to be able to capture not a half hour of news a day, but to capture 24 hours of news content a day. So the cost of production went down dramatically. You know, he moved out of LA and New York as the center for news gathering and went to a non-union town called Atlanta, Georgia. And he moved away from celebrity presenters and went to people we'd never heard of before. And people laughed when he started CNN, but they aren't laughing anymore. So I think that another one of the building blocks for the economic model is to look at a model where the people who get the subscription fees aren't the people who have the content, but are the ones who give you quality of bandwidth. So that means it's going to go to the big guys who are building networks. That you have to build large audiences if you're going to get advertising. You can't build large audiences unless you have quality of programming. The programming has got to be better than television, otherwise go watch television. There's going to be 500 channels out there. Therefore, you've got to have, you know, quality experiences, and those quality experiences, if they're going to be entertainment-centric, aren't going to look much like, you know, working on a spreadsheet. And so that's why I think we're at this discontinuous moment of change. And if we go back to the building block that has been so much the discussion of this conference for the last 2 days, which is the socialization experience of avatars representing, you know, human spirits, and people being able to, you know, cross the boundaries of distance and cross the boundaries of time with time shifting, and the ability to integrate intelligent agents who can take on the form of an avatar with humans who can take on the form of an avatar, and the ability to create socializing experiences. This is not being created by the big media asset companies that I was talking about previously. This content is being created by all of us who are out there using it. Again, let's look for some examples. Talk radio is cheap content. Chat is inexpensive because talk is cheap. And so I think another one of the driving forces behind all of this is going to be chat. And I think chat communities are going to be increasingly important because you get self-organizing groups, you get people creating the content, random things happen in ways that you can't predict. And I believe that's going to be another one of the driving forces that's going to help shape the economics of this industry. Now, some years ago, Alan Kay and I started working on an idea that we eventually called the Knowledge Navigator. And that was back in 1987. And I wrote a book that talked about that. And we eventually created a video about the Knowledge Navigator. And at the time that we showed the Knowledge Navigator, I got pillaged. Because they said, there he goes again, this marketing guy who doesn't know anything about technology, he's trying to tell us what computers are going to look like. Well, the honest answer is I didn't know, and I don't think I know now an awful lot about computers. But what we did think was that it wasn't going to be a projectable picture out there in terms of what the computer industry would evolve into. Because we could see, even back in the 1980s, that communications and content and computing was starting to come together. It was pretty obvious that these things were going to happen at some point in time. And so what the Knowledge Navigator was about was going around and peeking inside as many laboratories as we could get access to and looking at the things that were percolating. So it wasn't that we were clairvoyant. It's that it takes a certain amount of time for new technologies to go from the discovery phase to, you know, let's try it out, the experimentation, to eventually it gets commercialized and usually fails the first or second time, and then eventually, you know, something comes out of that experience curve which is successful. And so we were just peeking inside of things that other people were already working on. And so the Knowledge Navigator actually got a few things right. You know, one of the things it got right was that computing was going to be more about communications than it was about computation. And so the Knowledge Navigator was about navigating, going around. Now, what we didn't know at that time was that the internet was going to be the means by which all this was going to explode into an incredible phenomenon. We weren't smart enough to figure that one out. But if you look at the Knowledge Navigator video, those who have seen it, or if you ever go back and look at it, if you haven't seen it, what you will see is something that looks very much like what's out there today with a Netscape Navigator or an Internet Explorer or the kinds of things which are shown in demos, you know, around this whole today. It had multimedia, it had socialization of people communicating with each other, it had an experience which tapped into databases as well as to the knowledge of individuals. And it was all about communications and socialization. And out of that, it gave us the ability to sort of set a framework to say, well, what kinds of things should we be looking at seriously at Apple for new technologies? And one of those turned out to be called HyperCard and HyperCard. And another one, because you had to have a way of hyperlinking. Another one of those became QuickTime, because we said, gee, if you're going to mix all of this media and you've got a time dimension to media, then you've got to be able to time sequence media. And that was the beginning ideas behind QuickTime. There are clearly many things that haven't been implemented. And many of those, I think, are being worked on by all of you. And that's why I find this conference so incredibly exciting, because I think a lot of the ideas of avatars go way beyond what we were looking at with the intelligent agent, you know, inside the Knowledge Navigator. I don't think we got that nearly as right as I have heard in the discussions here and seen some of the demos over the last couple of days. So we got some of the things right, but we also missed a lot of the key things. Now, what I'm doing with my life is actually having an absolute ball because I'm out living on the edge again, very close to where a lot of you are. Not exactly into Vermal and into avatars yet, but very much into the kinds of things that are still part of how do we turn the Knowledge Navigator into reality. And so we had at this conference four of the companies that I'm involved with presenting. And what we're focused on is just one part of all of this, but it's, as several of the participants here have said, we all got to work together. You know, this is the era of the internet, where in internet time, nobody does it by themselves. It's by definition in communications requires things to be open. Nobody will accept proprietary technologies anymore. And so you've got to be able to leverage off of each other's experiences. And that's what we're trying to do here. And so we tried to share with you some of ours. And one of our companies is called RealSpace. And this is the team started by Eric Chen. That Eric used to be the chief architect for QuickTime VR. And he put together a company that went out and said, gee, this is a really neat idea, but let's optimize it for the web and get it implemented in a very small footprint. And then he said, gee, we've got to live in a world of avatars and image objects. And so he came up with a toolkit which allows you to be able to map in all kinds of 3D objects and sprites and bomb shading and different effects and directional sounds and the kinds of things that you would expect in a really good experience. And then we looked at it with another one of the companies that I'm involved in, which is called Live Picture, and said, boy, this is amazing, but it still suffers from the same problem QuickTime did, and that is when you pan and zoom a 360-degree panoramic image, it pixelates. So why not get rid of the pixels? And in our company, Live Picture, we had been working on the development of a base technology, which again is open and free to anybody who wants to use it, called FlashPix, that we developed with Hewlett-Packard, Kodak, and Microsoft, the largest printer company, the largest desktop software company, the largest photography company, to be, in effect, digital film. And that has been optimized for viewing and printing over intranets and intranets. Now we said, why don't we take the same server modules and server suites that we're building for the print world, and let's optimize to the screen, which means dynamic images, and let's take the pixels out of real VR. And so we've been working with Eric and his team to do exactly that. So when you zoom in on an image, it's not counterintuitive, and it gets pixelated, it actually gets sharpened. And then we said, well, how do we turn this all into an experience that people could actually enjoy in the web? And there we did two things. We formed a relationship with another company, which was formed by some former Apple people. Peter Friedman and a team took the original eWorld business and created TalkCity.com, which is now up to 350 chat forums a week. And we took TalkCity and we said, let's create a combination of the panoramic images with directional sound and this photorealism that can be delivered over 28.8 modems on the internet, and let's also integrate a community chat with it, so it gives you a chat experience that goes beyond text. And so it's VR plus chat. And then we said we've got to have some really neat content. So we went to another one of the companies that we're involved in, which is called Seismic Entertainment. And they're doing virtual expeditions, adventure travel, going to remote locations in the world, because this team came out of NASA Ames and JPL. And they said, let's build on those relationships. And so they have a team right now that's down in the Taylor Valley of the Antarctic, which is using Eric Chen's technology to film the meteorite that came from Mars, where there was evidence of life. And we have another team that's getting ready to go under the polar ice cap for another one of these adventures. And there'll be live conferences with expert hosts moderating these things, which will be in photorealism, that you can zoom in and look at it in detail. You'll be able to meet together with other people in forums and chat about what you hear. So it's a learning experience as well as a fun experience. And so talk and travel are part of that idea. We have another one in Palenque, which is a part of the Mayan ruins. We've got special permission from the Mexican government to show. And there are many, many other locations around the world with seismic plans to do. Well, this is just one small piece of the puzzle. It's not that photorealism by itself is the ultimate in communities, but it certainly adds to the building blocks that we all can use. And what we hope comes out of all of this at the conference is that this will stimulate your ideas to say, gee, why don't we take what you're doing and look at what we're doing and figure out how to do something that lets us take the idea in another direction or even some better implementations. And it's this exchange of ideas. So when I think of what a virtual community looks like, in my mind, this is a virtual community. Now, I know we're all physically here, but we could actually be avatars of our own selves. But we're here, and I was watching this earlier as I was thinking about it, and if this was C-SPAN, we would have one camera focused up here at the panel, and it's kind of like broadcasting, looking through a peephole, what is going on. But as a community, I was looking around, and some people were fidgeting, and some people were standing in line at the microphone, and some people were talking to each other, and some people were writing notes, and conversations were going on, and people were walking in and out, and that's what really happens in a community. And so what we need to do is to figure out, we've got a special interest group, Bruce brought us all together. Now, how do we take this kind of experience that is happening in a real community, as has been formed here this weekend, and implement that in a virtual community? Because once we start to capture that, that's another step in the building block. Now, it's not part of this primordial soup where we're trying to reinvent the basic structure of life, but it's certainly a step beyond where we are today. And I think if we look back 10 years from now at this conference, Bruce, I hope we'll be able to say, some of those things that we take for granted now, in the year 2006, are things that, were just, ideas that were a glimmer in our eye back in 1996. And that's how all this stuff happened. One last comment. I firmly believe that each new media takes on the form of the media that precedes it before it finds its own expression. And if you think about the first moving pictures, they were filming stage plays. And the first television was radio shows that were given visualization. And the first multimedia on computers followed the same approach, because what they did was to take little windows of video that looked very much like television windows and say, that's multimedia. In my mind, that is not multimedia. That's just putting television through a computer screen. Real multimedia is what I think can come out of this whole conference and the work that's associated with it. And Vermal 1.0, gave us a beginning. It gave us 3D visualization. And Vermal 2.0 gave us a little bit more. We could start to see some multimedia, and we could start to see behaviors. The big question is, what happens after Vermal 2.0? And I don't claim to have any particular insight into it, but I sure hope that we are expansive enough in our thinking to realize that we're not trying to create television on the computer. We're not trying to make the desktop look better. We're not trying to improve the home page. That's not what it's about. What it's about is finding the identity, the personality for cyberspace that will be as successful as the identity that we found for documents with the desktop icons and metaphors that have created this wonderful industry called the personal computer industry. And so it's got to be a lot more ambitious than anything we perhaps have ever done before, because it really is about communications, and it really is about interactivity, and it really is about synthetic worlds, and it really is about community, and it's about content that is entertaining, and it's about content that is educating us so that we are part of this knowledge economy. And so we've got some very, very ambitious missions ahead of us. And if we set our sights any lower than living up to that, then we will underdeliver. Simple things like in the area that we're working in with photorealism, we aren't Vermal, but we sure have got to find a way that the photorealistic backgrounds, whether it's digital backlots or whether it's photo texture projection mapping, you know, 3D primitives that are used in the construction of avatars, you know, that those things can coexist in natural ways. And so I hope that what comes out of this is not only a chance to come back again next year, and please sign me up, Bruce, if you do it. But I hope what comes out of it is that there is a constant building on the things that I saw happening over the last couple of days. It's been a wonderful experience for me. I hope it's been as exciting experience for all of you. And thank you very, very much for letting me be a part of it.
Next year?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I want to, before we get to the formal closing awards and announcement of the party that's coming up, I want to give a few additional, sort of a tie-in to John's presentation. Putting on the record, if there's anybody who's writing a record here, a record for cyberspace. In a spring morning in 1973, at the first building at the Xerox Palo Alto Research Center, Alan Kay and Butler Lamson and Bob Taylor and a whole bunch of engineers, mostly, had a pretty huge tube, and they had a whole bunch of chips, $7,000 worth of memory chips, to drive a screen, a bitmap display, first, you know, bitmap display. And they wanted to bring a new medium into being, which was this whole idea of the field of pixels upon which you can paint imagination, paint the whole future, and an architecture of information. And they got the thing up, and it came up white screen, all pixels lit up. And one said, well, there's nothing to put here. So we've got to go out and invent a scanner. So what's a scanner? We'll invent that. So they invented that, and they scanned in an object. And the first object to appear on a bitmap display was an avatar.
Oh, wow.
It was a Cookie Monster. it was flipped back and forth. Cookie Monster. This is 1973. Cookie Monster eating a cookie. So, just a little thought of where we're coming from.
Come a long way.
And where are we going? Well, I have a particular passion about this whole phenomenon. I hope to live into the 21st century, far into the 21st century, to see where this goes. Because I think, stretch your imagination out a little wider. Stretch it up to 5 billion years. Now, this is, I know it's late on Sunday, but just stretch it out to 5 billion years. The Earth, what are we doing when we're sitting in our cabins in Santa Cruz County and building digital forests and they're cutting down river trees? What's going on here? Well, what are we doing? We're creating a mass extinction on the planet right now. We're destroying the creation of a world that took 4.5 billion years to arise. But this has happened before. We're not the only ones that have done this. Earth's gone through mass extinctions, the Permian extinction, a whole bunch of volcanoes decided to erupt at once and goodbye. It was worse than a nuclear winter. It went for 3 million years and killed 90% of all life forms. Earth got through that. There was an earlier extinction. The Earth used to be a lot like Venus. It used to be pretty yucky atmosphere. It used to be all like L.A. and the only thing that could live in that Earth, apart from starving film stars, were small organisms that ate things out of the atmosphere, gucky things. They ate chemicals. And they ate the chemicals so well that the sunshine came through. And then one of the gucky things got a little green spot in it, we call it chlorophyll, and it said, game over. And a mass extinction occurred, and all the orange things disappeared. But there's another mass extinction. Of course, we all know about the famous meteorite impact or whatever it was. And we're doing it again. Humanity's doing it. And perhaps it's the second time that the Earth's biology has done a mass extinction on itself. But what happens after a mass extinction? Well, an enormous new number of niches are opened up. They're not just you know, that the city was destroyed, so now there's more places to put McDonald's or something. But the niches are opened up, and tremendous complexity and diversity have reappeared. The niches filled, instead of 4-foot-long dragonflies, you have pterodactyls and you have birds. But we're killing a lot of things right now. And the Earth's biosphere, if it has a collective mind, may be on the verge of saying, okay, I've really done it now. I've created these things that are very, very effective mass extinctors. They're very effective creators of uniformity in biology. And I don't like it, because I wasn't put here just to create the uniform biology. 20 species of organisms, all nice, neat rows, trees and rows. Nature must hate that. Nature must hate Europe. But so the Earth is, the biosphere is about this eruption that's going on. It's constantly grappling with chaos, and it's encompassing it. It lives in chaos. Chaos runs through it. So what are we doing? We're creating, I think, and I think a lot of other people are starting to suspect this too. We're creating a new primordial soup. And so perhaps in the 21st century, this is why you're creating things that are getting more and more behaviors in these worlds, not just avatars. You're creating, as you know, Stephen Hawking might say, the genes, our genes, are driving themselves always to reproduce. So where are they driving themselves to reproduce to next? It's maybe in the digital realm. Why? Maybe the Earth's biosphere has a bigger plan, because there's probably only one way to get life off the planet. Because organic compounds don't survive very well in our vacuum. And we're not going to get to the stars in a Star Trek type of scenario with tanks and 19th century technology battles and all those things. We're going to need living spaceships. And we're going to be in symbiosis, because the world, the environment out there is incredibly harsher and more complex and more wondrous than you can imagine. And it can kill you in the shortest time as you can ever imagine. So for us to be ready for the Earth to express itself outside of its embryo, it needs new tools. The genes need to be put into a new place. And perhaps this is what we're going to do. Think about that a little bit. So anyway, with that...